Up in the sky. It's a bird.
It's a plane.
It's been confirmed that the aliens have landed.
Man, that's a real shame when folks be throwing away a perfectly good white boy like that.
And look at this. Look at it.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the BNATL show at the Epicenter of Hope, Hope Distribution Studios. I'm your host, Bert Starzer. Thank you for tuning in on this glorious day. Before we start today's topic, I'd like to mention that if you have any questions regarding any topics covered, or if you have a prayer request or need, please visit my website, bnatl.com. That's all lowercase letters, bnatl.com. And email me. Just include your topic in the subject line, and I'll get back to you. So today's topic, I'm hoping, will ignite a flame within you, the flame of a prayer warrior. Believe it or not, there are plenty of folks in the mainstream media just itching for a story in which a follower of HaMashiach Yeshua, Jesus the Messiah, begins invoking some form of violence. Well, physical violence will never be invoked here. Physical violence was never taught by Jesus, and as followers of the Messiah, we should stay true to his teachings and his example. However, unless you have been hiding under a rock or completely unplugged from society, it's hard not to notice that we are at war. We are in a spiritual war, and things have just been taken to DEFCON 1. That's the most severe level. In Ephesians 6:12, Paul writes, "For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers, against the world forces of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places." We are at war. Everything from Christians being killed in the Middle East, to the butchering of the unborn here in the States, and even the homosexual movement that has stepped up its hateful rhetoric, all of these are spiritually motivated and spiritually driven. The motivation behind every action is spiritual. Yes, everyone is accountable for their actions and words, but the motivation at the core of every word spoken and deed done is first spiritual. In Matthew 6:24, Jesus says, "No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth." Now, obviously, he was referring to wealth and the love of money in this passage, but the principles are the same for everything. In John 8:34, Jesus says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who commits sin is the slave of sin." In Romans 6:16, Paul writes, "Do you not know that when you present yourselves to someone as slaves for obedience, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin resulting in death, or of obedience resulting in righteousness." See, it doesn't matter what the motivation is. It can be greed, lust, coveting, or hate, and murder. Even if the motivation is love, hope, joy, charity, or peace, whatever the motivation of our hearts is, that is what we become slaves to. And whether anyone wants to hear this or not, we are either slaves to righteousness, which leads to life, or we are slaves to sin, which leads to death. We either serve the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, or we don't. We serve ourselves or some other false god. There is no gray area when it comes to serving God. So before we begin to arm ourselves for battle and prayer and become prayer warriors, we need to understand who we are, but we also need to be reminded of who we serve. Paul says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." All of us have sinned. In fact, in 1 John 1:8, it reads, "If we say that we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves and the truth is not in us." We are all sons and daughters of Adam the disobedient. Sin is part of our DNA. We can't help it. But in 1 John 1:9 it continues, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." Before we step into our prayer closets, we need to humble ourselves before Almighty God. We, in and of ourselves, can do nothing. And that's an awesome thing, because the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob doesn't want us to depend on our flesh. He wants us to be completely dependent upon Him. The blood of Jesus, God's one and only Son, is the only thing that can cleanse us and wash away our sins. The blood of Jesus is where we need to begin as we prepare for spiritual battle. Once we have clothed ourselves with humility and the blood of Jesus, we then need to remember who we serve. Let's go back to Ephesians 1:18, where Paul writes some very powerful words and where we need to start in our understanding of who we serve. Paul writes, "I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened so that you will know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the surpassing greatness of his power toward us who believe. These are in accordance with the working of the strength of his might, which he brought about in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come." So once we have clothed ourselves in humility and the blood of Jesus for the forgiveness of our sins, we should pray for God to open our hearts so that we will know the hope of His calling and that we would understand His great power that is in all of us who believe. We have the Spirit of God within us. We are children of the only living God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And as children, we serve the Messiah, who is far above all rule, authority, dominion, and power. There is no one greater than Yeshua. No one. Let's continue. I hope you're getting excited, because this is incredible stuff. In Ephesians chapter 2:6, it reads, "And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with Him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages He might show the incomparable riches of His grace expressed in His kindness to us in Christ Jesus." See, we are seated with Yeshua. We are under His authority. And as a result, everything is under our authority through Him and because of His blood sacrifice. So as we enter into spiritual battle that is being waged, we clothe ourselves in humility and the blood of Jesus for the forgiveness of sins. Next, we need to remember we are children of the Most High God. And as children, we are heirs with Jesus, meaning we have dominion over every spiritual realm. Simply because Jesus is over and above all things, we are ruling with Him. Now, before we begin to pray, we need a strategy. The strategy has been and always will be for mercy and grace. Ephesians 2:6 says, "We are seated with Jesus in the heavenly realms." Why? So that God can show the world the incomparable riches of His grace. A little further in chapter 2, in verse 12, it reads, "Remember that at that time you were separated from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope, without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ." Our prayer strategy needs to be for God to fill us with His love and touch the hearts and lives of all we meet with His mercy and grace. I know for some of you this may sound very basic for spiritual warfare, and it is, but this is where we need to start. Before we can even begin to start tearing down true strongholds that have been built over decades, we need to attack the foundations of these strongholds. All the demonic strongholds that have ever been built have foundations consisting of lies and hate. Jesus tells us in John 8:44, "Why do you not understand what I am saying? It is because you cannot hear my word. You are of your father, the devil, and you want to do the desires of your father. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. Whenever he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own nature, for he is a liar and the father of lies." The only way to combat hate and lies is love, grace, mercy, and truth. We need to pray vigilantly for those who continue to follow after the devil and do his deeds. We need to pray for everyone's heart to be open so that they can understand there's a better way, that there is hope, that unconditional love does exist, that there is still time to repent and find mercy and grace, and above all, forgiveness of sins. We need to pray, ladies and gentlemen. We're at war. Make no mistake about it. But take heart and remember what Jesus tells us in John 16:33. He says, "These things I have spoken to you, so that in me you may have peace. In the world you have tribulation, but take courage. I have overcome the world." This is the BNATL show at the epicenter of hope, Hope Distribution Studios. I'm your host, Bert Starzo. Till next time, ladies and gentlemen, take care, be well, and God bless.
Till I die and they put me in the coffin. Yeah. It don't matter if I'm on the road or if I'm recording. Tell me what you think about me, that really ain't important. You know I'm a representative, I ain't playing, can't afford that. I only got one life, I'ma get it though. And this is not an act, not a movie, not a TV show. I don't know what quit me, I'll never take it slow. You know I'm on the grind, me and Toby in the studio. Go for the king, what you know about that? Say you going harder, I doubt that. Say you doing work, but you asking where the couch at. How you doing work when you asking where the couch at? You can use them when you wanna. You only look to heaven when you going through some drama. And when they going through some problems, that's the only time you call them. I guess I don't understand that life. Wonder why